Yes, a very good morning. So, little bit of confusion today regarding the stream. I don't know. Yesterday I had originally created one and that I was not able to connect it to the software for recording. And then I created this one at 10 a.m. but surprisingly it has come at 11:20. Right? So those of you are here, well and good. Others probably they can search for it later. Okay. Right, so 2 days we've discussed a few standards on auditing, right? Students are saying, Madam, you've covered a few standards. What about the other ones? So other ones, you can buy the entire, marathon revision, regular. Now you have so much of time to study for your May attempt. So it is like known as the May attempt, but you're going to write it in July. Right, so accordingly you can increase your level of preparations for the subject. Right, so it's like one of those very rare attempts where already from your office you got your leave in the month of January, February, or if you're writing a repeat attempt, say in the month of March, and then scheduled your April, and your exam scheduled to start from 1st of May, right? First, second, first week of May. So now May, June, and almost. Right, all good. Right, so now May, June, and almost the whole of July. So it's like all other people who ever will, whenever they will write the CA exams, they are going to envy this May 20 lot regarding the amount of bonus shares and regarding the amount of bonus amount of time which you have received for writing the exams. Okay, right, so all good. I hope every one of you have come over. Right, on the new stream which I have just created. Right, all good over here. Right, so today we are going to be, yes, discussing the chapter on professional ethics. Right, professional ethics, again, a very, very scoring part of your syllabus, for CA final audit. So earlier when it used to be 100 marks of entire theory paper, we used to see around 4 questions of ethics in the exam. So each question 4 marks, so 4 into 4, 16 marks. But now with the 30 marks of MCQ and 70 marks of the theory part of the paper, in the 70 part of the paper, 70 marks theory part of the paper, we are now seeing 3 questions on ethics. Right, we are seeing over there 3 questions on ethics, right? So 4, 4, 4, right? So around 12 marks of ethics over there. And in the MCQ, around 1 or 2 questions on ethics, right? So one question could be of 2 marks, one question could be of 1 mark. So around 2 to 3 marks of ethics is what we are seeing in the MCQ part of the paper also, right? So 12 marks in the theory part, that is 70%, 70 marks of the paper, and around 2 to 3 marks in the MCQ part of the paper, right? So around 15 marks. Right, so not a bad deal, no, that you study one chapter, but that one chapter is of 100 pages, so that's a different story altogether. Okay, right, so it's in that 15 marks of weightage for this chapter in the exams. Okay, once upon a time, long time back, institute used to ask 3 questions of ethics generally under one question. Like it used to be question number 3 and then question number 3A, 3B, 3C and say if 3D also, all 4 questions on ethics. So it used to be like a lottery, like 4 questions of ethics and all coming into one question. So certainly I will attempt question number 3. But now what does happen in the exam? Question number 3, one question of ethics, 2 from other chapters. Question number 4, again one question from ethics and 2 from other chapters. Question number 6, again one question from ethics and 2 from other chapters. No, you had counted upon ethics for getting that 40 marks in CA final audit. And 40 marks in CA final audit, difficult or very, very easy? It's like a, बाएं हाथ का खेल, और जो बाएं हाथ यूज करते हैं उनके लिए दाएं हाथ का खेल है ना, समथिंग लाइक दैट. टू गेट 40 इन ऑडिट, जस्ट 40 आउट ऑफ 100. यू से मैम यू आर यूजिंग द रॉन्ग एक्सप्रेशंस टू एक्सप्रेस दिस. इट इज नॉट फोर्टी, इट्स नॉट जस्ट 40 आउट ऑफ 100, इट इज 40 आउट ऑफ 100. यू नो के व्हाट इज द वैल्यू ऑफ गेटिंग दैट 40. Because audit, if you ignore the subject, if you don't do good amount of preparation, you do selective study in the subject, what happens with that subject? Favorite score of audit is in the series of 28 to 34, 35. Okay, I'm not telling your marks, I'm generalizing. Students say, oh, she's mentioned my marks. No, they might be your marks also. Okay, so what they say, ma'am, group 1, all good happening, but only this audit, it's creating a big a havoc over there. It's like a tsunami which has come into my life. Okay, why is that so? Right? Because the appropriate preparation, the content and all is yet to be prepared for the subject. Right, so anyways, right, let's start discussing the chapter. Okay, right, yes, I know value of 40. See, I know that you know the value of 40. Okay, some students, they get 80, 83 in audit also. And FR, SFM, so don't ask. They even get 90, 99. So when you see somebody getting 90, 99, in a practical subject also, sometimes I think ki three students ka mark have been secured by one student only. There are students who get 30, 30, 30. So if you take the total of these three students itself, then that one student has scored equivalent to that. Okay, right. So anyways, let's start with the chapter on professional ethics, right? Let's revise a few important clauses, a few important sections. Let's see from where the questions are coming in the exam. Right. So let's begin with, say, clause 5, part 1, second schedule. So I'm directly going to throw the clause numbers to you and then we are going to discuss. Right, we'll not go in a flow as we go in a regular class, starting with clause 1, part 1, first schedule, and going right up to clause 1, part 3, second schedule. That is how we study in a regular flow, no? But right now, I'll just pick it up randomly because it is a revision, we are going to revise it. Right, so clause 5, part 1, second schedule. Right, do you know where that is? Right, second schedule, part 1, in that clause 5. Right, what is that clause 5, part 1, second schedule? Right, anyone, do you remember? Do you know? Have you studied? Right, what is it? How do you start? It is part 1, second schedule. So, how will you start your sentence? As per, yes, everybody with me? Clause 5, part 1, second schedule to the Chartered Accountants Act 1949. A chartered accountant in practice is deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct if he, what? Fails to disclose a material fact. Right? When are you guilty of professional misconduct under 512? When you fail to disclose a material fact. It's not 522, it is 512. Right, fails to disclose a material fact known to him. Yes, is it known to the chartered accountant who is doing the audit of that entity? Yes, known to him, but he fails to disclose the material fact known to him, which is not disclosed in the financial statements. Right, which is not disclosed in the financial statements, but disclosure of which is necessary in making such financial statements, where he is concerned with such financial statements in a professional capacity. Right, fails to disclose a material fact known to him, which is not disclosed in the financial statements, where disclosure of such fact is necessary in the financial statements, right? Where he is concerned with such financial statements in a professional capacity. Fails to disclose a material fact. The very favorite question of the institute from 512 is regarding the provident fund. Right, a PF trust has been created, and out of this PF trust, loan has been given by the PF trust to the employer company. And this information the auditor has given only to the trustees of the PF trust, but not to the beneficiaries, the subscribers of the PF trust. Right, he should have given this information to the beneficiaries, the subscribers of the PF trust, saying that loan has been given out of the PF trust to the employer company. Right, so loan being given, then debenture trust deed, it is debenture redemption reserve, sinking fund not created, right, reduction of share capital done during the year but not disclosed. So what are all these? All these are examples of fails to disclose a material fact. Everybody, are you understanding, remembering? Right, 512, fails to disclose a material fact. Right, then after that, say, let's come to 221. Oh, it's a roller coaster, right? All of a sudden from 512 going to 221. First, you have to find, something in the house. Okay, where is the battery in the house? And all of a sudden, light goes after a long time. Okay, and if the light goes during this class going on, you need to wait for a few minutes till my Wi-Fi connection comes back. Okay, right. So now you have to search for the battery in the house. So you start searching drawer. Last time here, it was kept here. Last time I see, remember keeping, seeing it over here. Or generally, it is kept here. And so you're also now you have to be on a search, you have to work like a search engine now. Right, so clause 2, part 2, first schedule. Right, what is part 2, first schedule? Right, so, yes, professional misconduct for CA in service. Right, professional misconduct for CA in service. And what does it say over there? A chartered accountant in service or a chartered accountant not in practice shall be deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct if he accepts or agrees to accept any part of the fees, profits or gains from CA, lawyer, agent, broker, customer by way of commission or gratification. Right, what is 221? Accepts or agrees to accept any part of the fees, profits or gains from CA, lawyer, agent, broker, customer by way of commission or gratification. Right, CA in service guilty of professional misconduct if he accepts a share. Right, from CA, lawyer, agent, broker, customer of his employer. How? By way of commission or gratification. Right, so a CA in service referred a particular lawyer to his employer. A CA in service, this is a question which has been asked, no? Old course, new course, both. Right, a CA in service referred a particular lawyer to his employer. The lawyer, out of the professional fees received from the employer, paid a referral fee to the CA. Right, so this will come under which, is under which clause? Clause 2, part 2, first schedule. Right, clause 2, part 2, first schedule. Right, ICAI is asking me that on which date did you join a particular firm as an employee or from which date did you start practicing? As an example, right, say ICAI is writing a letter or sending a letter, an email to any chartered accountant and asking them, okay, how many articles are registered under you? Which date did you start working in a firm? Which date did you start your practice? Any such information being called for by ICAI. And this chartered accountant, whether he is in service or whether he is in practice, he is not replying to the letters of ICAI. He is not giving the information which has been called for by the institute or its functionaries. Right, now you tell me the clause. I have told you the content. Now reverse. Right, you tell me the clause. ICAI is asking for information from a chartered accountant, whether in practice or whether in service. No reply so far. Right, chartered accountant, whether in practice or service, and that CA is not replying to the letters of the institute. He is not supplying the information to ICAI. Right, not giving the information to ICAI. Wonderful, right? Amara Manikanta, first one to reply. 231. Right, clause 2, part 3, first schedule. What is clause 2, part 3, first schedule? Does not supply the information called for or does not comply with the requirements asked for by ICAI and or its functionaries. Right, are you all with me? Not. So see, this is how in the exam also, when you will see a case study that, oh, CA is being told to submit form number 18, the stupid fellow, okay, you should not say stupid, but then he is not submitting the information to ICAI. So which clause is going to be guilty of professional misconduct, right? Which clause is going to be guilty? Right, all of you are right now. Right, clause 2, part 3, first schedule. 122 is wrong over there, now 122 is contravenes. I'm talking about not giving information to ICAI. Oh, that's a wonderful, amazing response. So, you know, when the question comes in the exam also, all of you are going to write this clause in the exam. I'm very happy for all of you. Okay, right. So, does not supply the information called for or does not comply with the requirements asked for by ICAI and or its functionaries. Right. Is it clear to everyone who comes under the functionaries of ICAI? Right, the board of discipline, disciplinary committee, the quality review board, the appellate authority, right, the director discipline, right, any of them, right, the council of ICAI or its committees, the secretary which is working for the council, any of them asking for the information from the institute and you don't supply that information, right, guilty of professional misconduct under 231. Right, somebody wrongly, I think it should be that somebody is writing 322, 232, they are wrong. Just rectify. What is the correct one? Clause 2, part 3, first schedule. Okay, now next one. Listen to me carefully. Right, CA H has been appointed as an internal auditor of Jio Limited. CA H has been appointed as an internal auditor of Jio Limited. CA Y is the statutory auditor of Jio Limited. So CA H is appointed as an internal auditor and CA Y is the statutory auditor of Jio Limited. Right, the statutory auditor has made a complaint to the institute that internal auditor has accepted the appointment of internal auditor of Jio Limited without obtaining a no objection certificate from me. Right, without communicating with the previous auditor. Right, is CAY justified in making a complaint to the institute for the same? I repeat my question. CAH has been appointed as an internal auditor. CAY is the statutory auditor. Why the statutory auditor has made a complaint to the institute that CAH, the internal auditor, has accepted the appointment without communicating with them, with me, without communicating with the statutory auditor. Right, first of all, which clause? Yes, wonderful. Yes, Jakhotia, I'm talking about clause 8, part 1, first schedule. Right, I'm talking about NOC. But in this case, now tell me next, is CAH guilty of professional misconduct or no? Is CAH guilty of professional misconduct or no? Not guilty. Wonderful, right? Ankita Dudani, she's replied first. Not guilty of professional misconduct. Why not guilty? Because NOC is required to be obtained for replacement position and not for the parallel position. Right? NOC is required to be obtained by the auditor for replacement when one auditor is being replaced by another auditor and not for the parallel position. Right? Statutory auditor, internal auditor, they are parallel position. They are parallel position. Internal auditor is not required to obtain an NOC from statutory auditor or vice versa. Right, so that is why the complaint made by CAY that you know that internal auditor has not communicated with me before accepting the internal audit is not acceptable, it is not tenable, and therefore CAY is not guilty, CAH is not guilty of professional misconduct. Right, what are the wordings of 811? Right, as per clause 8 of part 1 of first schedule to the Chartered Accountants Act 1949, a chartered accountant in practice is deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct if he, what? You're saying no, I'm not saying it on your behalf. You say on your behalf, okay. Nobody is going to do anything on your behalf. That first thing you should understand in life. That you have to take responsibility for yourself. Oh, you know this revision class. Oh, you know that other thing. Oh, you know the internet. Okay, that all is secondary. You take charge and responsibility of your life. Right, so anyways, tell me, 811, what is it? Accepts appointment as an auditor previously held by another chartered accountant without first communicating with him in writing. Those of you who've done my regular class, I've always emphasized in the class that in the exams, when a question on ethics is being asked, word by word, writing the clause, the number of the clause, the content of the clause, very, very important. Right? So, accepts appointment as an auditor previously held by another chartered accountant without first communicating with him in writing. Right, so how do I send a request for NOC? Has the Council of ICAI clarified anything about it? Right, has the Council of ICAI clarified anything about it? How to send the request for NOC, outgoing auditor to incoming auditor? Yes, I'm waiting for a reply. Right, 811, that is right. But how to send the request for NOC, outgoing auditor to incoming auditor? How to send the request for NOC? Yes. How to send the request for NOC? By? Yes, RPAD, Divisha Bagga, perfect. Yes, Bagga, perfect. Registered post acknowledgement due or by hand against the written acknowledgement and not under the certificate of posting. Right, how to send the request for NOC? By registered post acknowledgement due or by hand against written acknowledgement and not under the certificate of posting. Why not under certificate of posting? Because in that case there is no positive evidence regarding the communication with the auditor. Right, so that is why RPAD, registered post acknowledgement due or by hand against the written acknowledgement, so that there is positive evidence regarding the communication with the outgoing auditor, right, with the incoming auditor. Okay, right, CA practice, he is doing tax audit, he is doing GST audit, you know, he is doing lot of income tax consultancy, right? Big, huge amount of practice, but you know, human greed, there is no end to it, right? So then he says that, no, let me do some personal recruitment and selection also on behalf of my clients. Right, let me do some personal recruitment. Okay, my client says I require 10 more engineers, software engineer, technicians and all. CA says no problem, I will recruit those people for you. I will help you. I will give them training also. I will take the interview also. I will decide their job profile also. All I will do it for you. Right? So can a CA in practice provide such personal recruitment and selection services to his client? Yes. Next one. I am waiting for the answer. Right? Personal recruitment and selection. Can a CA provide such services to his client? Okay, you're still, no, Sheetal Kapoor, 1111, not coming over here. Yes, email is also allowed. Okay, 144, no, 231, 2911, no. Why 1111? Who is no? Why people are going to 1111, 1011, 214, Aleka, oh, you've gone on the top. But yes, Chakrabarti, you are right. Yes, first one, 224. Right, I'm talking about members who are deemed to be in practice, right, as per section 224 of the Chartered Accountants Act 1949. Right, what does it say? A member of the institute where individually or in partnership with other CAs in practice for remuneration received or to be received renders such other services as in the opinion of the council may be rendered by CAs in practice. Right, I'm talking about the personal recruitment selection example which I gave right now, right? That is regarding the 224. Right, as per, everybody with me, are you paying attention? As per section 224 of the Chartered Accountants Act 1949, right, a member of the institute is deemed to be in practice when individually or in partnership with other CAs in practice for remuneration received or to be received renders such other services as in the opinion of the council may be rendered by CAs in practice. And then what does it say? The term other services includes. What does the term other services includes? Right, the term other services includes management consultancy and other services. And management consultancy and other services includes personal recruitment and selection. Right, in the given case, the CA is providing the personal recruitment and selection services to his client, which is included in the list of the MCOS, and that is why the CA is not guilty of professional misconduct. Right? That is why the CA is not guilty of professional misconduct. In the same, you know, again, now the CA in practice, he says, TK, I have done tax audit, GST audit done. Now I have started with personal recruitment selection also done. Now he says, next, let me start with broking, underwriting and portfolio management services. He says, lot of companies coming with IPO, so you know, underwriters required, stock exchange trading, okay, so he says brokers required and people are having so much wealth and net worth, so portfolio management services certainly required. So CA in practice now decides, okay, so now next new branch of business for me, providing broking, underwriting and portfolio management services. Will that be allowed? Right, is that included in the list of MCOS, broking, underwriting and portfolio management services? No, it is not allowed. Specifically, it has been mentioned over there. Right, that acting as advisor or consultant to an issue, allowed. But broking, underwriting and portfolio management services, not allowed. So if a CA in practice provides broking, underwriting or the portfolio management services, he is going to be guilty of professional misconduct under the charter, relevant provisions of the Chartered Accountants Act. Here it is going to be section 224, which is regarding the members who are deemed to be in practice. Right, members who are deemed to be in practice. Is that clear to everyone? Okay, right, next one. Right, now you tell me the most important clause out of the 34 clauses of ethics. Right, the most important, celebrated, where maximum number of questions are asked in the exams, which is the clause in ethics, clause 6, part 1, first schedule, 611. right? Which clause am I talking to you about right now? Clause 6, part 1, first schedule, right? What is clause 6, part 1, first schedule? Right? Can you tell me? Right? Clause 6, part 1, first schedule. What is it about? Tell me the first word. 611. Yes, it is 611. Tell me the first word. What does 611 talk about? K. Mahesh and all. Rohit Jindal, Siddharth Jain, Sethia. Yes, all of you. Right? Tell me what is a solicitation. Yes, I just saw that word. Right? Solicits. Right? Client or professional work, directly or indirectly. By? Yes, as per clause 6 of part 1 of first schedule to the Chartered Accountants Act 1949, a chartered accountant in practice is deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct if he solicits client or professional work directly or indirectly by circular, advertisement, personal communication, interview or by any other means. Right? C-A-P-I-B. Circular, advertisement, personal communication, interview or by any other means. Right? Provided that, two exceptions to 611. Provided that nothing contained herein shall be construed as preventing or prohibiting. Right? Provided that nothing contained herein shall be construed as preventing or prohibiting a member from applying, requesting, inviting, securing professional work from another CA in practice. That is within the CA fraternity. Is solicitation allowed? Yes. What does it say? Provided that nothing contained herein shall be construed as preventing or prohibiting a member from applying, requesting, inviting, securing professional work from another CA in practice or responding to tenders or inquiries issued by various users of professional services from time to time and getting the professional work as a consequence. Right? What does it say? Provided that, yes, second one over there, responding to tenders or inquiries issued by various users of professional services from time to time and getting the professional work as a consequence. Right? So, tenders and inquiries, again for that there are some guidelines issued by ICAI. Right? What does it say regarding the tenders and inquiries? If it is open for other professionals along with chartered accountant, then CA, you can respond to any tender or inquiry. It is exclusively for chartered accountants, right? Two possibilities. No, it is open for other professional also responding to tender inquiry, or it is only for the chartered accountants. Right, exclusively for CAs. The next condition, whether the minimum fees have been prescribed in the tender document itself. Right, minimum fees have been prescribed in the tender document itself. Yes, minimum fees have been prescribed. It says then CA, you can respond to that tender or inquiry. There will be no guilty of professional misconduct. But no, minimum fees have not been prescribed in the tender document and it is exclusively for CAs. Then CA, you should not respond to such tender or inquiry. When minimum fees have not been prescribed, still CA responds to that tender or inquiry, then he is guilty of professional misconduct under 611. Right, minimum fees not prescribed, still CA responded to the tender or inquiry, then he is going to be guilty of professional misconduct under 611. Right, so clause 6, part 1, first schedule, solicits. Right, client or professional work. Right, one more very important question over there is regarding the representation under section 144(3) of the Companies Act in case of the removal of the company auditor. Right, so can a retiring auditor make a representation in writing? Yes, but it should not amount to any solicitation. Right, if he solicits, he says, I have contributed a lot to improve the controls in the company. He makes unsubstantiated derogatory remarks against the management. Then that will also be coming under clause 6, part 1, first schedule. Right, that is regarding the solicits. Okay, right, now coming to another one. Okay. I was appointed to do the audit of a private or a public limited company and they told me that, see auditor, the date of our meeting has been decided to be 18th of May. Right? So at the time of appointment itself, has the client told me that, see what is the date of their meeting or by which date do they want the audit report and the audited financial statements? 18th of May. Okay, and now I started doing the audit. Say in mid-April, I started with the audit, checking cash in bank, inventory, debtor, share capital, different areas. Okay, and now slowly doing the work, going one day to client, again 2 days not going, then checking little, okay, sitting at one client place and doing some other client work or something like that. And that is why 18th May arose, it came. And had the auditor completed his work? No. Did the auditor submit his audit report on as per the requirement of the client, as per the statutory requirement? No. Right, as client had told him that we want the report on this date, CA was not able to submit the report. And because CA was not able to submit the report on the date decided, that is why client was not able to comply with the statutory requirements. Right, wonderful. Yes, Uday has already mentioned that is 712. Right, that is clause 7, part 1, second schedule. Where is the CA going to be guilty of professional misconduct when he is not able to submit his report on time so that the company can comply with statutory requirements? Clause 7, part 1, second schedule. Right, what is clause 7, part 1, second schedule? Right, does not exercise due diligence or is grossly negligent in the conduct of his professional duties. What does it say? Does not exercise due diligence or is grossly negligent in the conduct of his professional duties, right? Guilty of professional misconduct under 712. Right, does not exercise the due diligence. That means the CA is not doing his work with skill, care and caution. He is not being reasonably cautious and careful while discharging his professional duties. Right, so like, you know, say CA has not found out the contraventions with Schedule 3. Right, CA accepted arbitrary valuation of closing stock. CA signed two balance sheets for the same year. Right, so what are all these? The CA did not check how huge amount of revenue expenditure has been capitalized. All these are examples of gross negligence on the part of the chartered accountant. Right, all these are examples of gross negligence on the part of the chartered accountant. So, guilty of professional misconduct under 712. Okay, right, so 712 is regarding what? It is regarding the gross negligence. Okay, right, say let me come to another question. Okay, a client has appointed, Jio Limited has appointed CA for doing some cost optimization services. That client wants to reduce the cost of production, you know, they want to improve their operational efficiency, they want to reduce the cost, and that is why they have appointed the CA for providing some cost optimization services. And you know, after the CA provided these cost optimization services, say the client was able to save some 10 lakh rupees. And out of all the ideas and you know, the findings of the chartered accountant, the client was able to save some 10 lakh rupees. And now the fees are to be paid because the client, the CA has helped the client with cost optimization. So client says, okay, you've helped us with how much? 10 lakh cost we've been able to reduce because of you. So that is why 10% of that 10 lakh, you know, 1 lakh you take it as your fee for providing the cost optimization services. Did you understand the question? Right, CA has been appointed by client to provide cost optimization service. How much benefit did the client receive? Say 10 lakh rupee benefit. And now client is saying that CA, you charge your fee, or CA itself proposes that I will charge a fee on the basis of 10% of the benefit derived. So you give me 1 lakh rupee fee. Right, so what is it? It is 10-1-1. Wonderful, right? Many of you have replied that 10-1-1. And second part, tell me, is he guilty or not guilty? Your clause is correct, 10-1-1, and a percentage contingent basis fees, but is he guilty or not guilty? Right, the CA who charged client fees on based on percentage of benefit derived, yes, is he guilty or not guilty of, not guilty, wonderful, right? Ayushi Agarwal has replied, not guilty of professional misconduct, right? And many of you have also mentioned that it comes under the list of exceptions of 10-1-1, right? It comes under the list of exceptions of 10-1-1. Right, so what is clause 10, part 1, first schedule? Is as per clause 10. Yes, please say it with me. Right, let everybody at home also realize that yes, you are doing a revision class and there is some teacher who is revising ethics. So even your parents and family members will feel good that apart from some other songs which he keeps singing the whole day, today something it looks like this person is studying. Right, I hope all of you are sitting straight while attending this class, not that you are sitting on some sofa, relaxed or you know, just like that, huh, okay, theek hai, ma'am is telling. Don't do that. Sit straight. Be disciplined. Be ready for the class. At least now sit straight, yaar. Some of you are like, oh, she's seeing, but anyway, she's not seeing, but God is seeing you. Okay, right. As per clause 10 of part 1 of first schedule to the Chartered Accountants Act 1949, a chartered accountant in practice is deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct if he charges or offers to charge. Yes, are you all with me? Right, charges or offers to charge, accepts or offers to accept in respect of his professional employment any fees which are based on percentage of profits or which are contingent upon the results of his findings or of such employment except as permitted under the regulations under the Act. Right, percentage contingent basis fees, guilty of professional misconduct under 10(1)(1). What does it say? Except as permitted under the regulations under the Act. Right? What are the exceptions under the regulations under the Act? We have 8 exceptions over there. What are the 8 exceptions? Receiver, liquidator, auditor of a cooperative society, valuer for direct taxes and duties. Are you all with me? Right? What are the first 3? Receiver, liquidator, auditor of a cooperative society, valuer for direct taxes and duties. Certain management consultancy services, certain fundraising services, debt recovery services, cost optimization service. The example, the case study which I took with you right now, right? Cost optimization service, where you can charge your fees based on percentage of the benefit derived, right? Or any other service or audit as may be decided by the council, right? So what are the other 5? Certain management consultancy services, certain fundraising services, debt recovery services, cost optimization service, and any other service or audit as may be decided by the council. Right? In the given case, the CA has charged the fees to the client based on the percentage of the benefit derived, and it is allowed under the list of exceptions given in the regulation, and therefore CA is not guilty of professional misconduct. Okay. What happens when a CA is guilty of professional misconduct under first schedule? To whom does the matter go to? Under any part, part 1, 2, 3, 4 of the first schedule, if a chartered accountant is guilty of professional misconduct or other misconduct, to whom is the matter further referred to? Right? To whom is the matter further referred to? Right, debt recovery, cost optimization. What question I'm asking you? If the CA, if the matter is relating to the first schedule, to whom does the matter further go to? Right, not guilty, MCS, management, bank audit. Oh no, why bank audit has come over here? No, bank audit is not coming. Satya, yes. That is not coming over. Board of discipline. Wonderful. Yes, Naga Kirti has replied. Right, board of discipline. Right, the matter is referred to the Board of Discipline. And what are the actions which can be taken by the Board of Discipline? 3 actions which can be taken if the member is found to be guilty of professional misconduct or other misconduct. Reprimand the member, that is, give a warning. Right, second, remove the name of the member up to a period of 3 months or impose a fine of up to rupees 1 lakh. Right, reprimand the member, remove the name of the member up to a period of 3 months or impose a fine of up to rupees 1 lakh. And what if the matter is related to the second schedule or both the schedule? Right, second schedule or both the schedule. Right, then to whom is the matter referred to? Right, second situation. First situation, yes, second one, UD has replied, disciplinary committee. Right, then the matter is referred to the disciplinary committee. And then what if the member is guilty of professional or other misconduct under second schedule or both schedule? What are the actions which can be taken against that member? Again, first one, reprimand the member, that is, give a warning. Second one, remove the name of the member permanently or for any period. So that means second schedule seems to be much more stringent. Right, remove the name of the member permanently or for any period or impose a fine of up to rupees 5 lakh. Under Board of Discipline, it is impose a fine of up to rupees 1 lakh. Second schedule, both schedule, it says impose a fine of up to rupees 5 lakh. Right, is that clear to everyone? Okay, right. Now you tell me, what is clause 3, part 1, second schedule? Right, continuously your CPU, no? It has to work at a non-stop speed. Right, next question, next clause I've already asked you. Tell me, what is clause 3, part 1, second schedule? 312, clause 3, part 1, second schedule. ओके राइट, आई एम वेटिंग फॉर द आंसर फॉर क्लॉज 3 पार्ट 1 सेकंड शेड्यूल एस्टिमेट्स फोरकास्ट राइट. पूजा बाला आयुषी अग्रवाल दे रिप्लाइड ओके एंड देन मेनी अदर्स हैव आल्सो रिप्लाइड ओके. सो व्हाट इज इट फोरकास्ट राइट एज पर क्लॉज 3 ऑफ पार्ट 1 ऑफ सेकंड शेड्यूल टू द चार्टर्ड अकाउंटेंट्स एक्ट 1949 अ चार्टर्ड अकाउंटेंट इन प्रैक्टिस इज डीम्ड टू बी गिल्टी ऑफ प्रोफेशनल मिसकंडक्ट इफ ही सर्टिफाइज right if he permits his name to be used in connection with right sorry if he permits his name to be used in connection with estimate of earnings contingent upon future transaction in the manner which may lead to the belief that he vouches for the accuracy of the forecast right. What does it say? 312 if he permits his name to be used in connection with estimate of earnings contingent upon future transaction. What does this mean? Estimate of earning contingent upon future transaction, prospective financial information. And a contingent upon future transaction means it is going to be based on assumption. So if he permits his name to be used in connection with estimate of earnings contingent upon future transaction in the manner which may lead to the belief that he vouches for the accuracy of the forecast. Right, so CA in practice, if you vouch for the accuracy of forecast, guilty of professional misconduct under 312. Right, so does that mean that CA in practice, you cannot associate your name with a forecast? Can you associate your name with a forecast? CA in practice, can he associate his name with a forecast? Yes, subject to four conditions. Right, basis of forecast should be given. Right, major assumption should be disclosed. Sources of information and he should not vouch for the accuracy of the forecast. But if you vouch for the accuracy of the forecast, then guilty of professional misconduct under clause 3, part 1, second schedule. Okay, right. Now another one. Right, CA. Okay, he is again say a practicing CA. Right, and he has many clients, receipt, expenditure, article, stipend to be paid, staff salary to be paid and all of that. Right, so lot of income expenditure, receipts and expenditure. So, you know, he is just maintaining a diary for the same. And a diary, like New Year, you know, Diwali time, your friends, relatives, clients might gift you some diary, you know. So, in that diary, he is maintaining a record, you know, of all income that he's earned, all the expenditure that he's incurred. And based on that, he is filing the income tax return. Okay. So that means if and the income tax return, are there any books of account or so maintained? No. On the basis of that New Year diary which has been received, the CA is keeping the record of receipts and expenditure over there and accordingly he is filing the income tax return. And if they ask that why are you not maintaining books of account, he says no, my income is below the limits for you know tax audit for maintenance of books of account and all. Right, 44AA. So that is why I'm not maintaining the books of account. Right, the CA in practice, is he going to be guilty of professional misconduct and which clause? Right, two answers I want from all of you. 112, no, little bit wrong. Section 27, where you went, Malesh ji, maintenance or 122, Pavitra Kannan, right, 122, contravenes. Right, any of the provisions of this act or the regulations made there under or the guidelines issued by the council. Right, practicing CA from day one of practice, irrespective of the limits under the Income Tax Act for maintenance of books of account, practicing CA from day one of practice, you have to maintain proper books of account, including cash book and ledger. Right, a practicing CA from day one of practice, irrespective of the limits for maintenance of books of account as per Income Tax Act, is required to maintain proper books of account including cash book and ledger. Right, this has been told by ICAI by way of a notification. Right, that practicing CA, books of account, cash book and ledger. And what if any of these books of account are not maintained? Right, any of these notification is not followed, then guilty of professional misconduct under 122. Right, what is 122? Contravenes. Right, any of the provisions of this act or the regulations made there under or the guidelines issued by the council. Right, everybody, are you understanding that? So CA, this CA, where is he going to be guilty of professional misconduct? 122. what is 122 contravenes any of the provisions of this act or the regulations made there under or the guidelines issued by the council. Okay, right. So today we are talking a lot about practicing chartered accountant. Okay, so say there is a practicing chartered accountant, say in the city of Mumbai. Okay, and now his name and fame has spread beyond Mumbai, or say beyond the, you know, city municipal limits or so. And that is why he's opened one more office in the suburbs of the city, which are 60 kilometers away from the main office. And for that other office over there, he has appointed a BCom graduate to take care of that other office, which is 60 kilometers away from the main office in the Mumbai city, main office in the main Mumbai city. Okay, so CA in practice, can he have more than one offices? Yes. And now this CA, where is his other office? It is 60 kilometers away from the main office. So, and who is in charge of that other office? Say some BCom graduate. Right. Is this chartered accountant guilty? And what provision of the, yes, 27, wonderful, Siddharth Jain, right? Before that also some of you have replied. Okay, right, section 27 of the Chartered Accountants Act is what I'm talking about, which is regarding the maintenance of the branch offices, right? Section 27. And what does section 27 say? That each branch office or each office of a CA should be under a separate charge of a member of the institute. Right, you remember that each office of a CA should be under the separate charge of a member of the institute unless, right, the second office is located. So the exemption is only for the second office if it is located in the same city or if it is located in the same accommodation or if it is located within 50 kilometers from the municipal limits of the city in which this first office is located. Right, so what does it say? What is when second office, when no CA, no separate charge of member is required for the second office if it is located in the same city or if it is located in the same accommodation or if it is within 50 kilometers from the municipal limits of the city in which the first office is located. And the example which I gave you, I told you clearly it is 60 kilometers away. Right, so that is why in this case, is the member going to be guilty of professional misconduct under the Chartered Accountants Act? Yes, why? Because he is not complied with the provisions of Section 27, which says that each office of a CA should be under the separate charge of a member of the institute. Right, each office of a CA should be under the separate charge of a member of the institute. Okay. Right. Okay. Now this chartered accountant, right, he has required to pay his monthly GST. You know, the GST is required to be paid by, not say a chartered accountant, by any of the client of the CA. Okay. So now this client is very occupied with his work. So he tells the CA that, CA, I'll give you this 20 lakh rupees in advance. So as and when the GST liability keeps on coming, you please keep on paying the GST on my behalf. Right, so client has given how much? 20 lakh rupees to the CA for the whole year, right, to pay his GST liability on or before the due date. Okay, so now client money is with the chartered accountant. What the CA did, for first 3 months he paid the GST on or before the due date, and now he says still time, no, remaining 9 months, so still time. So why not for the time being I invest this client money in my mutual fund portfolio? And then as and when the liability of GST come, I will remove the money from the mutual fund portfolio and I will pay the GST liability of the client. Very good idea. No, it's not very good. It's very bad. Tell me, which clause of ethics is he guilty of professional misconduct? Wonderful. 10.1.2. Right? What is that? Clause 10, part 1, second schedule. Right? Clause 10, part 1, second schedule. What does it say? If he fails to keep monies belonging to his client other than fees or remuneration in a separate banking account or to use such monies for the purposes intended by the client within a reasonable time. Right? Fails to keep monies belonging to his client other than fees or remuneration in a separate banking account or to use such monies for the purposes intended by the client within a reasonable time. Right, so in the given case, why has the client given you the money? For paying the GST liability. Right, have you used it for the purpose intended by the client? No, you've put it in your mutual fund portfolio. Right, so that is why guilty of professional misconduct under 10.1.2. right? 10, 1, 2. Is it clear to everyone? Okay. Now, CA wants to have, you know, CA wants a stake in an educational institution, CA in practice, right? He wants to provide coaching, or he has some interest in an educational institution, right? Other than the coaching organization of the institute, the CA wants to be associated with any other educational institution, CA in practice. Yes, which clause of ethics am I talking about? Right, 10.1.2, wonderful. Yes, separate bank account, 422, why 422 has come, Anusha Ramakuri? No, 422 is what? Defalcates, embezzles money received in professional capacity. Okay, so in combination of 10.1.2, you want to write that. Yes, wonderful, they've replied, Hetal Lakha, yes, Lakhataria, right, 11.1.1, right, what is that? That is regarding the permission. What did I tell you? CA in practice, right, engages, he wants interest in an educational institution. Right, he has interest in an educational institution or want to teach in any educational institution other than the coaching organization of the institute. Specific prior permission of the council is required to be taken under 11.1.1. Right, what is 11.1.1? Engages in any other business or occupation other than the profession of chartered accountancy. Right, what is 11.1.1? Guilty of professional misconduct if he engages in any other business or occupation other than the profession of chartered accountancy unless permitted by the council so to engage. Right, unless permitted by the council so to engage, provided that nothing contained herein shall disentitle a member from being a director unless he or his partners are interested in such a company as an auditor. So can a CA in practice become a director in a company without any permission? Yes, director simplicitor, that is other than managing whole-time director. And then under clause 11.1.1, the council of ICAI has issued two lists. Right, permission granted generally and permission to be taken specifically. Right, so specific prior approval of the council required in each case. Right, so that is clause 11, part 1, first schedule. Right, tell me what is 222? Right, clause 2, part 2, second schedule. Right, and 25 hours per week, what you are mentioning, that is the total, including the coaching organization of institute and other than coaching organization of the institute, it should not exceed 25 hours per week. His direct teaching hours should not exceed 25 hours a week. That question, we've also seen it in the MCQ. Right, so what am I talking about? 222. Right, clause 2, part 2, second schedule. Right, network concept, it is, I thought I would take it in this class. I'll quickly discuss the definition of network. But if you look into the YouTube video, RTP Amendments May 20, Part 1, there the entire concept of network has been discussed. So it would be a repetition if I take it again over here. So you can go to that video. I was going to mention that as somebody has put it over here, I'm telling about it. Right, so you can go to the RTP May 20, RTP Amendments May 20 or May 20 Amendments video, part 1. Right, part 1 over there is regarding the network form and part 2 is regarding the SEBI LODR amendment which has come in RTP May 20. Anyways, right, what is 222? Right, 222 is regarding the breach of confidentiality CA in service. Right, being an employee of any company, firm or person discloses information regarding his employer to any person unless required by any law for the time being enforced or taken prior consent of the employer. Right, so breach of confidentiality CA in service is under 222 and breach of confidentiality CA in practice. Right, breach of confidentiality CA in practice, that comes under, right, so CA in service is 222, CA in practice, right, breach of confidentiality, CA in practice, yes, confidential information, material facts, no, Vinay, not material facts coming over here. Network concept, it is interrelated to which clauses, 2, 3, 4, 5 of part 1 of first schedule. Right, 112, yes, Chavi Jaiswal has replied to that, right, 112, breach of confidentiality CA in practice, right, as per clause 1, of Part 1 of Second Schedule to the Chartered Accountants Act 1949. A chartered accountant in practice is deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct if he discloses information acquired in the course of his professional engagement to any person other than his client, unless required by any law for the time being enforced or taken prior consent of the client. Right, so breach of confidentiality, CA in practice, guilty of professional misconduct under 112, and CA in service, guilty of CA in service, guilty of professional misconduct under 222. Okay, right. If you look at the RTP May 20, it is now talking about the concept of the network firms. Right, so the entire concept of what could be the name of the network, the registration of the network with ICAI, the bylaws of the network firm, right, then the managing committee of the network firm, all that is discussed in the RTP May 20 amendments part 1 video, which is already there on my YouTube channel. Okay, but just to quickly revise with you the definition of the network which they've given over there. Right, so many CA firms, whether within India or you could have a network association outside India also, right, coming together. What is the definition of network given over there? Network means a larger structure, right? So just rather than being a firm or individual, now it is said to be a larger structure. And why are you forming a larger structure, a bigger structure? Right, so what is the first, what do you say, idea behind creating that larger structure? The point over there says is aimed at cooperation. Right, so what is the main purpose of creating a network, a larger structure? It is aimed at cooperation. That is first golden rule. And in addition to this aimed at cooperation, it also clearly aims at. So this is the fixed, okay, aimed at cooperation. Matlab, this is compulsory. And apart from this one compulsory point, any one of the following six could also be, has to be there together with it. So it could be one plus all the six, or one plus any one of those six, or two or three, any number. Right. So what is first one? It says network means a larger structure which is aimed at cooperation. Yes, that is golden one. And now the other six. And which clearly aims at the profit or the cost sharing. Right, so another intention why you're getting into a larger structure, in order to have profit or cost sharing. Or where you're having a common business strategy, you want to be known as GST consultants, you know, GST experts across the country. Right, so common business strategy, you want to expand your tax practices, whatever. Right, so you can't use the designation GST consultant, that will be guilty otherwise under 711. But yes, they want to increase their GST expert, you know, their tax practice. Right, so what is that? That is the common business strategy. Or there is common management ownership or control. Right, so all the firms which are there in that network, they are coming under the common management ownership or control. Or they have the common quality control policies and procedures. Right, common QCPP, SQC1, Standard on Quality Control 1. Right, common quality control policies and procedures. Or the use of a common brand name. Right, they are using one brand name, say Deloitte, EY, PwC, KPMG. Right, so say their registered entity name in India could be different, but the brand name is one and the same. Right, so the use of a common brand name, or a significant part sharing of the professional resources. Right, or sharing of a significant part of the professional resources. Right, so the point how you remember the definition over here is 1 plus 6. What is that one over there? Right, a network is a larger structure which is aimed at cooperation. And apart from cooperation, what are the other 6 points which could be attached to it? Right, it clearly aims at the profit or the cost sharing. Or they have a common business strategy. Or they have the common management ownership or control. Or the common quality control policies and procedures. Or the use of a common brand name, or the significant share of the professional resources, right? Significant part of the professional resources are being shared, right? So that, and this network, they are discussing it under which clause of ethics? Under clause 2, 3, 4, 5 of part 1 of first schedule. What is 2, 3, 4, 5 of part 1 of first schedule? Right, clause 2 is regarding pays or allows or agrees to pay or allow, sharing by CA in practice. 3 is regarding accepts or agrees to accept, so accepting by CA in practice. 4 is regarding enters into partnership in or outside India, so that is 411. And 511 secures professional business. right? So 2, 3, 4, 5 is where they are talking. They've introduced the concept of network over there. Right, one last one, if you could tell me, what is 241? Right, 241. Quickly, is the file opening? 241. Is default gates, embezzles, money received in professional capacity. Okay, right. What is 241? Oh, Bhagyashree Bapte has typed in the chat the entire point regarding the network. Very good. Huh? I'm very impressed. Okay. Right. What is 241? It is regarding the disrepute, other misconduct, whether CA in practice or in service, right? Generally. Right, as per clause 2 of part 4 of first schedule to the Chartered Accountants Act 1949, a chartered accountant, whether in practice or not, shall be deemed to be guilty of other misconduct if he, in the opinion of the council, brings disrepute to the profession or to the institute as a result of his action, whether or not related to his professional work. Right, in the opinion of the council, brings disrepute to the profession or to the institute as a result of his action, whether or not related to his professional work. Right, can we discuss some examples of bringing disrepute to the profession? Right, CA retains the books of account of the client and fails to return them to the client without a reasonable cost. Right, so CA retains books of account of the client. Right, then after that, right, CA adopted coercive methods on the bank for obtaining a loan from the bank. CA used the services of his article for other than professional practice. Yes, all these would be the examples of the other misconduct. CA forged the will of his relative. Right, CA makes a material misrepresentation. Right, so all these are going to be examples of bringing disrepute to the profession. All of these are going to be example of guilty of other misconduct under clause 2, part 4, first schedule. Right, so now what is your agenda for the rest of the day? Right, you will again do a revision of ethics in all different permutation combination. Right, going clause by clause, then going randomly, then going from clause to question, then going from question to clause. Right, and then tomorrow we'll be having a discussion on CARO 2016. Right, CARO 2020 not applicable for July 20 attempt. Anyways, May 20, July 20 not applicable. And for November also, as of now, we don't know whether it will be applicable, because in practical life also the applicability of CARO 2020 has been deferred by 1 year. Right, and in CARO 2016, CARO 2020, the CARO 2020 is a higher version of CARO 2016. So all what is there in CARO 2016, except for that one clause, all of that is also there in CARO 2020 also. You understand, right? So tomorrow 10 o'clock we'll be discussing regarding CARO 2016. We'll be revising CARO 2016, and I'll be also starting tomorrow 11:30 to 12:30 with the inter audit revision discussion. So right now, this 1st May to 8th May, 10 to 11 in the morning, we are having discussion for CA final audit. Right, from tomorrow, from 4th of May to 8th of May, 11:30 to 12:30 is going to be the discussion for the inter audit. Right, in the live stream batches, for those who are having their exams in November 20 or May 21, November 21 or any time whenever you plan to write. Right, the live stream batches are starting on 9th of May 2020. Right, 29th of May, 10 to 1:30, right, 10 a.m. to 1:30, and for more details, you can visit aartilahoti.com. Right, thank you so much.